sorry, on the working group on slavery and visual culture that was, we've organized several events this quarter to ruminate on afterlives as a conceptual frame for thinking about legacies of enslavement in the Americas and its particular relationship to regimes of visuality. So this is part of a year-long series of events that offer theoretical and artistic ruminations on afterlives. Let me just double check one second. Everybody can hear and see me. Everybody hearing and see me? Yes? Okay, good. I guess. Okay, so this is just one of several events that we planned this year that will offer theoretical and artistic ruminations on afterlives. Today's theoretical meditation will be followed by the launch of a digital exhibit in March titled Visualizing or Performing Blackness in the Afterlives of Slavery. The exhibit will feature the artistic work of contemporary performance artists from Jamaica, Colombia, Puerto Rico, Venezuela, Trinidad, the U.S. Virgin Islands, the Dominican Republic, and Cuba. And we certainly hope that you will join us for the launch of the exhibit and the conversatorio, or the conversation that will take place with the artists. Anyway, without further ado, today I have the distinct pleasure of introducing the esteemed members of our roundtable, Deborah Thomas, who's the author of Political Life in the Wake of the Plantation, Slavery, Witnessing and Repair. Thomas is a Brownlee Professor of Anthropology at the University of Chicago. We also have Lorgia García Peña, the Roy G. Klaus Associate Professor of Romance Languages and Literatures and of History and Literature at Harvard University. She's the author of The Borders of Dominicanidad, Race, Nation, and Archives of Contradictions. And last but certainly not least, Tavia Nyong'o, who's a Chair and Professor of Theater and Performance Studies, Professor of African American and American Studies at Yale University. Nyong'o is the author of Afrofabulations, The Queer Drama of Black Life. Just brief logistic information in preparation for a discussion that will take place at the end of each of the panelists' presentation. We're asking you to use the question and answer tab to pose your questions. You're welcome, or in fact, we invite you to pose them during or right after a particular speaker. And then if you see a question that is very similar to yours, we ask that you like it so that we can push it up the queue. And then at the end of the last presentation, Isabella will collate the questions and we'll pose it to the guests. So please pose your questions throughout in the question and answer tab. And if you need to, you're invited to let us know the person to whom you'd like the question to be directed. So just to frame our conversation, last quarter we had met to read and discuss the work of each of these panelists. And when we met, I mean, you know, members of the working group met, I did not foresee the recent insurrection of white supremacist violence that engulfed the Capitol. The events are shocking, but they operate under the auspices of or in tandem with larger structural violence, mass death, economic precarity, accelerated displacement, heightened surveillance, imperialism, ecological destruction, uprising and rebellion. And these realities are organized and contoured by the regimes of raciality that emerge from histories of enslavement. So put simply, the attempted coup underscores the urgency and necessity of critically examining what it means to live in the afterlives of slavery. Because these eruptions of racial violence are the lived and felt reverberations of the slave past. And so just in my opening remarks, I want to just settle on the notion of reverberations as a means of thinking through afterlives. And I think reverberations seem useful here because it encapsulates the eruptions that follow a defining event of racial formation, its sonic and sensory proliferation and diffusion across time and space, in and across bodies. And as this working group is most preoccupied with regimes of visuality, we're thinking about how such reverberations come to the fore through modes of seeing or not seeing Blackness. So reverberations enable us perhaps to attend to the affective and visual dimensions of living in the wake, or what Deborah Thomas calls archives of feeling, and to consider how histories of enslavement have defined the category of the human, the formation of the subject, notions of sovereignty, and contemporary discourses of anti-Blackness. So Reverberations invites us to consider the continuities of racial violence, and more importantly, as Deborah points us, to consider what it means to bear witness to racial violence in the afterlives of plantation, and to ask what does repair look like as we face this violence. Reverberations perhaps also seems apropos for understanding the particular challenges and questions that the notion of afterlives pose to us. And these questions are temporal. How does one make sense of a past that so persists in the present? What are the temporal regimes that organize life in the wake of slavery or in the wake of the plantation? In Afrofabulations, Tavia invites us to think about the afterlives as being about a polytemporality, a present that unfolds from seeds of the past that it always contains, or a crystal that one sees through splinters. And this is a temporality that defies linear time and the temporal regime of the nation state. So Reverberations are polytemporal and disparate. They can be found in gestures, visual art practices that activate and preserve varying memories of slavery, and that challenge the historical racial schema that continue to shape the organization of today's world. The problems that the afterlives pose is also one of historicity. The afterlife is a place from which we are rehistoricizing, or where we seek to challenge the frames and conceptual idioms that organize official history to address its limitations, silences, and the erasures of the archives. So each panelist attends to these limitations, as we discussed in our meeting last year. Tavia affirms the value of speculation and fabulation to engage the problems of history. Deborah offers us archives of feeling, and in our analysis of the Dominican Republic, Lorgia responds to the erasure of racialized subjects from the archive and the nation. She suggests that these silences are not only found in the erasure of Blackness from the historical and rhetorical narratives of the Dominican Republic, but they are also enacted and normalized through speech acts. So we can find the reverberation in the diction that she analyzes. She asks us to consider how the racial Blackness is performatively enacted in the very enunciation of particular histories and narratives of national identity. And so these reverberations, I think, are important, not only because they underscore the silences of the archives, but the gestures and disruptions found in the repertoires of Black resistance and performance practice in the Americas. And finally, reverberations, I think, are crucial for engaging the problem of place and space when we think about living in the afterlives of slavery. In organizing this panel, I chose the hemispheric Americas as a site from which to theorize the afterlives, not only for my own selfish interests, of course, but also to seek to map and track these reverberations in and across competing sites of racial formation. And I thought it important to bring the Caribbean to this conversation because it is a formative theater of racial formation and locus of racial capitalism, a region that is born out of histories of enslavement, genocide, slavery, indentureship, and the realities of US hegemony. And I proposed a hemispheric conversation to think about the multiplicity and diverse plantation economies, political structures, histories of enslavement that shape constructs of Blackness, and that is in turn contoured by the geopolitical realities of US imperialism. And so it is this reconfiguration of space and power in the afterlives of slavery that is crucial to configuring Blackness as both hypervisible and invisible, a signifier of the criminal, the non-citizen, and the disposable across the Americas. And in thinking hemispherically about these reverberations, we can perhaps see more clearly how Blackness and grammars of racial representation have been contoured by geopolitical relations in the Americas. So this panel is itself a reverberation, a moment where we can sit and both think and feel critically about what it means to live in the afterlives of slavery. I invite Deborah to present.
Thanks, Danielle. You gave us a lot to chew on just there. I want to thank Danielle and Isabella for organizing this get together, and of course, Lorgia and Tavia, my co-panelists, whose work I admire a great deal. So it's very fun to share space with you. So I guess you've read the book. So most of you know that I have been interested in plantations as both material and aesthetic landscapes, and as spaces of imagination, and that I've been thinking about their lives and afterlives in both geopolitical and intimate registers. So my obsessions over the years have had to do with the Caribbean, of course, and with processes of coloniality in the Western Hemisphere. And like many of you, I've been grappling in different ways with the following questions. If the modern West was built on indigenous dispossession and slavery through the development of plantation-based agriculture, and if both indigenous and African-descended populations were excluded from modern personhood, then what could it possibly mean to be human politically in the wake of the West? How have people confronted the unpredictable afterlives of colonialism and slavery, nationalism and state formation in ways that perform not only a material transformation, but also an affective one? What does sovereignty feel like? And these are the questions that have been haunting me over the past many years as I've been developing archives of the relationships between sovereignty and violence in Jamaica. I'm going to share my screen. My specific obsessions have had to do with the temporal regimes to which post-colonial sovereignty projects have been tethered, how these have conditioned the affective states through which they're enacted and experienced, and how these have shaped the complex relationships between sovereignty and subjectivity within a context whose foundational infrastructures were imperialism, colonization, and plantation-based slavery. I've been interested in what Sylvia Winter identified as a constitutive tension between the dominant logic of the plantation and its internal threat, the often millennial spaces within which enslaved persons maintained a conception of themselves as human rather than as property. It's this tension that would ultimately shape the relationship between the national and the popular in struggles over sovereignty. And it's this tension that becomes legible by attending to both moments of exceptional violence and the realm of everyday practice. So if you've read the book, you know that my mode of attention to these tensions has been a form of bearing witness that I've been calling witnessing 2.0. So this is not the witnessing of human rights organizations or public tribunals like Truth and Reconciliation Commissions. Witnessing 2.0 is instead a quotidian practice of watching, listening, and feeling that is relational and profoundly intersubjective. It's a moral practice that involves exploring our complicity within contemporary events, what Avery Gordon has elaborated as responsibility. Witnessing 2.0 makes visible how affects operate in multiple temporalities and across levels of consciousness. It's a practice of recognition and love that destabilizes the boundaries between knowing and feeling, complicity and accountability, and one that potentially reformulates the ground of the human itself. So by focusing on the extent to which one recognizes the various ways we're implicated in the processes we address, witnessing 2.0 produces intimacies through the development of affective archives, while it also reveals the ways we maintain the conjunctures of power within which we live. It provides a means to take seriously embodied ways of knowing and understanding in an effort to track the long-term entanglements that have produced and sustained the binary structuring our modern world, so that we find ways to undo dualistic modalities of thinking and acting in order to generate meaningful forms of repair. So witnessing 2.0 can therefore ultimately produce the internal shifts in consciousness that radiate from one to another in unexpected and necessarily nonlinear ways, and that lead to lasting world-changing transformations. And for me, this is the imperative, right? We have to cultivate archives through affective embodied care in order to recognize and respond to the psychic and socio-political dynamics in which we're complicit, and therefore to generate the ability to be responsible to ourselves and to others. So Tivoli Stories has been our attempt at witnessing 2.0. And this is a project that explores in a range of forms, the 2010 state of emergency in West Kingston, Jamaica. And what you're watching are the images, but not the sound from the nonlinear experimental short film that we did. In May 2010, security forces went into Tivoli Gardens in order to capture Christopher Dodas Koch, who had been ordered for extradition to the United States. Officially, 74 civilians were killed during the operation, but the number community members gave us closer to 200. Beginning in 2012, I worked collaboratively with Junior Wedderburn and Deanne Bell on a multimodal project addressing these events. We assembled archives, including drone footage, archival footage, still and moving images of the contemporary landscape, still and video portraiture, and narratives. And we were interested in how bringing these archives together could generate a range of affective orientations, themselves differently apprehended based on one's location, politically, structurally, nationally, and psychically. And ultimately, we were interested in the forms of recognition that might be possible across these various locations, and in the extent to which visual archives might either generate them or make them unrealizable. So the project represents our attempt to bring into being a different ethical register, one that focuses on the quotidian expectations and experiences of social and political personhood or non-personhood within the neighborhood of Tivoli Gardens, and one that also creates a different kind of visual archive than that which is more publicly available. And there's a longer documentary as well that we've been showing. I've been calling them kind of guerrilla grassroots screenings as a means to catalyze conversation. And we have a moderated conversation after the fact. I can talk about that more during the Q&A if you want. So Tivoli Stories is in many ways a visual representation of the afterlives of the plantation, of a modern political organization created in, through, and against coloniality. It's a representation of our contemporary condition that speaks through the current discourse of crisis, the collapse of liberal democracy, the evisceration of a civil public sphere and of the notion of rights, and the erosion of the very health of the planet and any certainty regarding our environmental futures. But I've also been wondering over the past couple of years about what it would mean to frame an understanding of our contemporary condition in the language of epical shift rather than crisis. If we know that imperialism and slavery have many afterlives, what would it mean to assert that this moment constitutes another epical shift, the death of Western modernity? When Spain, Great Britain, the Netherlands, and France set sail to the so-called New World, they inaugurated a shift that generated new systems of economic production and consumption, new forms of social hierarchy, and new kinds of political relationship. These transformations led to the rise of the modern West and through white supremacy and imperialism, the global dominance of Western civilization. However, for the first time since 1492, we're seeing a real challenge to the dominance of the West, quote, the end of the world as we have known it, as Arif Derlich put in a recent special issue of American Quarterly. Derlich was referring to the growing influence of China globally, which is one dimension of the economic, political, and sociocultural shift that we're experiencing. And another has to do with transformations in the spatial and temporal organizing of policing, but I won't talk about that here. What I want to focus on in the brief time remaining has to do with what it would mean to ethnographically investigate an epical shift. How do we capture the everydayness of epical shifts? What forms of evidence can we mobilize to perceive shifts that aren't always understood as world-changing while they're happening? When they sneak up on us, or conversely, when they seem to just explode suddenly in our faces? How will we understand the work racism will do in a new epoch? And how will we identify the avenues through which people will refuse and resist it? I'm going to suggest that thinking the contemporary as epical shift rather than crisis requires a reconfiguration of the forms of intimacy and concepts of scale that have been normative within anthropology, and also a recalibration of what constitutes evidence. Of course, while we might imagine that an epical shift necessarily inaugurates novel relationships to concepts and experiences of sovereignty and security, we must also be attuned to the ways new global articulations of political and economic power enable new forms of struggle and therefore new channels toward accountability while also disabling others. So in thinking about how people are currently engaging the intensified presence in Jamaica, which is China's Caribbean hub, I've been probing three kinds of archives and spaces: rumors and discourses that circulate regarding the Chinese presence, the forms of activism that have developed in relation to Chinese development initiatives, and visual and sonic evidence, or the lack thereof, of the large-scale projects that have been announced. And here I'll talk briefly about the last of these in relation to the drive to develop Jamaica as a global logistics hub. And I'll focus on the development of a proposed aerotropolis in the southern part of the parish of Clarendon. Minister of Parliament for Central Clarendon, Mike Henry, had been pushing for a multimodal logistics hub at the former US Air Base at Vernon Field since 2007. Finally, in April 2017, the Jamaican cabinet approved a development plan that would include the revival of Jamaica's railway system, as well as facilities for manufacturing and assembling, meeting and expositions, and cargo logistics and bulk port containers. The Vernon Field Aerotropolis would also include the retooling of a local high school toward aviation and shipping trades, the movement of the Jamaica Defense Force Air Wing training facilities, and the creation of over 600,000 jobs. Speaking with residents in April 2018 at a local community meeting, Mike Henry promised that the Aerotropolis would, quote, form part of the global Silk Route, which links the Mediterranean, the Red Sea, with Southeast Asia and China. He continued, it will provide easy shipping access to the Panama Canal, the East Coast of the Americas, the Mediterranean, and the West Coast of Africa. In September 18, Henry further explained the novelty of the Aerotropolis. He said, the concept combines airport planning, urban planning, and business site planning to create a new sustainable urban form. It aims specifically to facilitate Jamaica becoming the fourth logistics hub in the world. And the other three are in Rotterdam, Singapore, and Dubai. I'm sharing my screen again. So there's a breathlessness about the future orientation of this language, and yet concerns raised by residents at the April 2018 meeting also evoke prior imperial moments. It was announced that some of those living in Gimimibit, the town that abuts the airstrip, would have to be relocated to accommodate the construction and security requirements of the plan. And at another meeting on January 15th last year, 2020, residents expressed concern that they might be forcibly removed from their land after having received letters in December 2019 from the National Land Agency notifying that the government had designated the Airports Authority of Jamaica to enter into negotiations to acquire the relevant parcels of land, each measuring between 20 and 33 acres. The 25 property owners in question unanimously refused the quote unquote ridiculously low and out of order offers that had been made by the National Land Agency. And many of the offers were indeed less than what some of the properties had been valued at only 3 years prior. 80 years earlier, residents in this same town had been removed and relocated when the US originally built the runway and other facilities for the airbase. Indeed, colonial records from the period document the expenditures related to compensation to people whose lands were expropriated by the United States. Nevertheless, the first phase of the $2.5 billion development project, that's US dollars, bushing the area and around the runway, which had, after its decommissioning by the US in 1949, been used as a drag racing venue, got underway in late 2018. Despite warnings from geographers within the earthquake unit that the location sits on alluvial deposits and therefore is not ideal for the construction of an aerodrome, phase two of the development plan, attracting necessary private investments, was to have begun shortly thereafter. And the Aerotropolis was projected to be completed by mid-2019. However, the film clips and the photographs that you're watching show images of how the area looked in October 2019, and then again in January and March 2020. You can see that the airstrip that was to have been closed at the end of September 2019 but my research collaborator, Junior Wedderburn, and I were driving the runway in mid-October. The road that runs from the town nearest the sea to the fisherman's beach had begun to be bushed and widened in October. We saw but did not photograph the bulldozers. But by January, much of the foliage had already grown back. And in March, taximen and residents alike were still using the airstrip as a conduit between the main road in Gimimibit and the road to Maypen, Clarendon's capital. So I'm laying out these starts and stops because the talk of Belt and Road can seem to permeate popular and policy discussion, and the future of Jamaica as a global logistics hub can appear as if it's just beyond the horizon. But even when plans seem to be underway, even when it looks like the government is going to take your land or that you'll be trained for a job in aviation services, you can never be fully sure these plans will materialize. People often chalk this up to a difference between Jamaica and China in terms of long-term planning. In Jamaica, many say planning is related to election cycles, but in China, they're looking at the long haul, 50 years in advance. This difference in scale will always disadvantage liberal democracies, but in illuminating the fantasies through which liberalism constantly constructs itself, it also alerts us to the potentialities that might inhere in the epical shift to which I'm drawing our attention. If Western modernity was rooted in the plantation, and if the dominant logics of the plantation, security, legibility, control, are also always potentially undone by that which it excluded, then a new dispensation might allow us to amplify forms of sovereignty that are not framed by the state or within the parameters of its institutions. For me, the point of bearing witness to state violence and other forms of violence, of creating different archives and affective relationships to violence, is to chart new terrain upon which sovereignty can be elaborated and radiated. My own position is that sovereignty cannot be disavowed as either false consciousness or ontological impossibility. It's not an event, but is constantly in process. It's constituted through the performative, affective, nonlinear, and unexpected ways, something that feels like freedom circulates and is transmitted from one to another. If this is the end of the world as we know it, the death of Western modernity and the rise of something else, then let us be attuned to the infrastructures that both that both enable and constrain these circulations and transmissions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Deborah. So I just want to emphasize to our attendees that we are asking you to please put your question or your comment in the question and answer either as they speak or at the end of the presentation so that when we get to the question and answer time, we already have your question to discuss. Please be sure to like a question. So if you see a question that resonates with you, please like it so it can be ushered to the front of the queue. Thank you very much, Deborah. We'll now invite Tavia to present.
Thank you, Danielle. And I can already tell that there's going to be a lot of reverberations across the three presentations. I'm really privileged to be thinking alongside Lorgia and Deborah, two people whose work I learned so much from. And I also want to thank Isabella and Pedro for the invitation and the assistance in being with you tonight. Danielle mentioned at the beginning that one of my interests is in Black polytemporality. And of course, one of the affordances of Zoom is that we're all in, or we potentially in different time zones. It's the middle of the night where I am right now. And that's perhaps appropriate since my presentation is about a film that is that's set in the middle of the night. So without further ado, I will share my screen, and hopefully if you don't hear the soundtrack, someone will let me know, but you should. Oops, no, that's stop share. Okay. I'll keep that low enough that you can hear me over it, hopefully. So not only can art give expression to what would otherwise remain inexpressible, it can provide an atmosphere in which our attachments to the given are suspended long enough to rearrange our relationship to the unacceptable. When it comes to Black art, which is to say art, this atmosphere can unravel routinized habits of thought, logic, and reason, infusing other modes of corporeal and inspirited cognition. But this disturbance of rationality should not detract attention from the rationality of the disturbance that Black art is and makes. The way an anti-Black world thinks about us may be the condition of our art, but it can never be its cause. Or maybe this is just to say that we have just cause, that when it comes to making art, we have our reasons. It's not just silly games. There is a scene in Steve McQueen's recent film, Lovers Rock, 2020, that resonates with my claim that Black art provides an atmospheric detachment from the givens of an anti-Black world. As the DJ of a house party cuts the track he has been playing, Janet Kay's 1979 hit, turn it out a little bit, there we go. Silly Games. The partygoers keep dancing and singing the lyrics in an impromptu, ecstatic chorus. The camera lingers on one dancer who repeatedly reaches for the high note on the final games and pans across another, older man, singing in deeper tones, who is none other than Dennis Bovell, the song's original writer. The density of this moment thus confounds the diegetic frame of the film. Oops, sorry, actually, didn't mean to do that. The density of this moment thus confounds the diegetic frame of the film, which centers on an all-night blues house party in West London in 1981. The setup, Martha, a teenage girl from a God-fearing household, sneaks out of her window to go to the party with her friend Patty, is seemingly borrowed from any number of Black American screwball comedies of the 1990s. At the party, Martha meets the handsome and gentlemanly Franklin, and they dance until dawn, kissing goodbye in the morning light as her bus pulls up. Her smiling return to bed in the final shot of the film, just as she is called for church, seems to secure the affinity of Lover's Rock with its comic premise. But between dusk and dawn, Lover's Rock traverses a whole affective spectrum of Black social life, plunging into both the thrills and the transgressions of the dance floor. And if McQueen's and Courtia Newland's screenplay is our guide into this nocturnal depths where romantic anticipation, erotic desire, and spiritual bliss somehow meet for the Black Londoners crowded into this house, the shape-shifting sound of Silly Games is our guide out of them. When I say that Lover's Rock gives us the atmosphere of Black art, I mean to invoke the smell of food, sweat, perfume, ganja, and liquor that swirls throughout the film. Like the aroma of ackee and rice, it is an atmosphere redolent of home, even as that home, Jamaica, is an epicenter of an ongoing disaster that has sent the parents of these Black youth fleeing, and is in that sense no home at all. The youth code switch between London slang and Jamaican patois, preserving the Queen's English for moments of tense interactions with white authority figures. Insofar as the blues makes a time and place for Rastafarianism, it is a form of rebellious Blackness that is disowned by its quote-unquote parent culture. The blues is not a recreation of Jamaica, but a way to let out the lion and feed my soul, as the DJ cries out at one point. Nothing per se comes of a blues, perhaps nothing need come of it. The requirement that Black performance do something in order to justify its existence is in itself part of a violent and hierarchical ordering of the world. The blues is profligate, exorbitant, wasteful. It expends the energy meant to be spent asleep, recovering from labor in order to return to more labor. It refuses even the sacrificial rituals of the church. The blues is a Black enclosure, surrounded, The tight space of the house, so crowded the wallpaper sweats, is less a world than a plenum, a filled and compressed space. Black bodies stomp on the floor and bang on the walls. They whine and they mosh. They sing and they chant down Babylon. This scene is nothing like an uncomplicated portrayal of Black joy. While Martha slow dances with Franklin, another dancer, Cynthia, is swept off her feet by Bammy, a swaggering sexual predator. Cynthia, whose birthday it is, accepts Bammy's come on only after she has herself been turned down by Franklin. Franklin and Martha are thus the happy couple, while Cynthia and Bammy are no couple at all, as Martha discovers shortly after this scene, when taking a break in the backyard, she hears Cynthia crying for help, runs to her aid, and stops Bammy from raping her in a corner of the garden. This shocking assault is set up during the Silly Games sequence, with Bammy heading towards Cynthia just as Janet Kay sings, "I've been watching you," adding a layer of retrospective menace to what was an innocent line. Lover's Rock underscores that there is no easy freedom for the dancing Black body, even the Black body dancing when no white people are watching. Indeed, the entangled intimacies of these four underscores the need to give an account of the circulation of touch among those who have never had a body, but rather its theft. The legacies of stolen bodies fall even upon Franklin and Martha, who in their very first conversation, after establishing that both families are from Jamaica, uneasily exchange various family surnames to spot a possible blood connection. Their budding romance is the afterlife of slavery. This is to say, with Rizvana Bradley, that, quote, thinking the haptic irreducibility of the aesthetic requires constant reattunement to the violence that to the violence touch occasions and to the violations which occasion touch, unquote. This is also to say, with Fred Moten, that Black art neither sutures nor is suture to trauma. There's no remembering, no healing. There is rather a perpetual cutting, a constancy of expansive and enfolding rupture and wound, a rewind that tends to exhaust the metaphysics upon which the idea of redress is grounded. I take a cue from Moten and Bradley to observe that the romantic plot of Lover's Rock does not redress, heal, or compensate for the violent counterplot. But neither is the Silly Games scene sutured, that is, held together with trauma. Both Cynthia and Martha's experiences are true, and both occur under the sign of Lover's Rock, considered as a genre. But how does Lover's Rock, considered as a film, seek to do aesthetic justice to this entanglement of joy and suffering, ecstasy and betrayal, without minimizing either? Let's go back a step and consider the two interlocking registers, musical and cinematic, through which this scene makes its impression. In the early moments of the film, women are cooking in the kitchen and singing Silly Games. The DJ, Samson, who has been setting up his equipment, stops momentarily at the kitchen doorway, grins, and pretends to conduct. At this moment, the seed of an idea is planted, one that is realized when, later that night, he cuts the music mid-song, confident that his audience will be able to carry the tune, just as the cooks earlier in the evening were. In moments like these, Lover's Rock displays an acute sensitivity to the looping rewind of Black aesthetic sociality, the way each cut can become a moment of expansion and wounding. As the sound fades out and the crowd carries and amplifies this tune, Lover's Rock rigorously enacts Moten's conception of the function of Black art. This function, I've been arguing, is occasioned by anti-Blackness, but never caused by it. The Blues Party exists, the larger Small Acts anthology of films makes clear, in the face of the virulent racism faced by Black migrants in Britain. When Martha steps into the street to look for her friend, she is immediately menaced by a roving wolf pack of white boys. When her cousin CJ attempts to crash the party, only the wail of an approaching police siren persuades the doorman to hustle him in and quickly shut the door. These moments exist to remind us that the pleasures in silly games are not simply taken, they are stolen, and that it is that fugitivity that requires a constant reattunement to the violence of hapticality. To be sure, McQueen is hardly a director given over to sugarcoating the realities of Black life. Indeed, part of the rapturous reception of Lover's Rock came from a sense that a particularly unrelenting director had relented and finally allowed his camera lens to dilate wide enough to take in a long, languorous scene of Black collective worldmaking. I think that in a way, McQueen, by his own admission, achieves this against himself, not through artistic mastery, but through a relinquishing, a letting go. And I think Janet Kay's Silly Games can tell us a bit about how this happens. Saidiya Hartman has famously revived the story plot distinction in narratology with her concept of critical fabulation, a playing with and rearranging the basic elements of the story. First developed in response to the violent erasures of the archive of the Middle Passage, critical fabulation has been embraced by a range of artists and critics, myself included, as an aesthetic of Black counter-memory. In narratology, the story is the sequence of events that happen, while the plot is the way in which those events are revealed. But in terms of my analysis of Lover's Rock, we might note a critical fabulation in the contrast between the plot of the film and the story in the music. That is to say, critical fabulation attunes us to the manner in which the song plays with, rearranges, and displaces the received account of what happens in the film. The story of Lover's Rock is the music, which builds from light pop and disco to Lover's Rock to reverberating dub as we move from dusk to dawn, from kung fu fighting to Ja Rastafari. The songs, actual songs from the era, precede and exceed the fiction into which they are plotted. We might understand the Silly Games scene, therefore, as exhibiting a tension between the cinematic and the musical, each pulling in a different direction. McQueen's directorial vision, in particular his signature long shot, is redirected by Janet Kay's lilting delivery of Silly Games, a song that provides an extraordinary moment of angular Black womanhood when the DJ cuts the track and people continue singing a cappella. In an interview, McQueen describes shooting this scene in rapturous terms and freely admits that it could only be captured on film by letting go of directorial control. The Silly Games moment would have happened whether or not he was there, whether or not the camera was there, McQueen explains. It was a moment that couldn't be scripted or planned. As an artist, you can never even hope for it. You can never even think of it. But the idea of being invited into that situation is what you kind of hope for. What is this moment you can hope for without hoping? What is this atmosphere that you can never even think of, except through the idea of being invited into it? This collective, improvisational, and intentionality is what I want to call the atmosphere of Black art, its capacity to produce not hope, so much as a non-optimistic refusal of pessimism. Another way of expressing the relation between sound and vision that I am after is in terms of the closed and the open. Over and over, across the Small Acts anthology of films, and this is Lover's Rock is the second of five films, McQueen focuses on enclosure and containment, whether it is the actual containment of Black bodies by schools, jails, and jails that are masked as schools, or whether he is considering the cramped spaces, a restaurant, a blues party, a modest home that Black people have carved out for themselves in a country that hates and fears them. In his cinema, enclosure redoubles on enclosure. It forms the only answer to the problem it manifests. His work can feel airless, unrelenting. In Lover's Rock, and especially in the Silly Games sequence, this closed system is opened, not by anything he does, but by something he lets go of. Like the DJ, imagining he is conducting the singing women in the kitchen, when in fact they are the chorus conducting him, the Queen hands the reins of his film over to Janet Kay, whose cut and augmented vocal line precedes and exceeds the cramped room of the blues. In the break of her voice as she hits that high note, joined by the chorus on the dance floor, Kay refuses the distinction between romance and politics that the received history of lover's rock wants to impose. The note pierces through any romantic or seductive plot that would contain it, enacting in sound what the lyrics of Silly Games aspire to, an enfleshed voice that resonates with all the terrible beauty and suffering that blackness can carry.
Thank you so much, Tavia. That was so beautiful and also really relaxing at the same time.
It is kind of relaxing, yeah, actually.
Tavia. Okay, so we just double checked that folks might be able to speak when they're ready to ask questions. So we still encourage you to write in your questions, but we also can let you know that you should be able to make comments based on what we're seeing here, and so we should be allowed to talk rather than write. But we encourage you to post your question in the chat. Okay, so thank you so much, Tavia. We now invite Lorgia to present.
Thank you so much, Danielle, for organizing this panel and for the invitation. Of course, Isabel and Pedro for all the organizational behind the scene works, and I cannot be more excited to be in conversation with Tavia and Deborah. I, of course, read your work and it has nourished mine. So I'm very grateful to be part of this conversation with both of you today. And I think it's a conversation that many of us have been in for a while, to think theoretically about the afterlife of slavery and to think about Blackness in and beyond the United States. I want to share with you briefly some of the theoretical questions from my current book project, that I'm embarking, which I'm calling Translating Blackness, in which I think precisely about the afterlife of slavery and colonialism through Black Latinidad, and more specifically through the multiple intersections that Black Latinx living in the global North allows us to engage. Blackness, colonialism, migration, diaspora, citizenship. Trying to the next slide, here we go. And I just wanna just a time out to clarify that when I talk about Black Latinx, I'm using the term to refer to people who are living in the global North, who are either immigrants themselves or descendants of immigrants, and trace their ethnicity and their culture back to Latin America. So what I term Translating Blackness, the epistemological, political, cultural practice of engaging Black transnationally and across historical paradigms beyond and through hegemonic US Blackness, is in many ways a political act that interrupts the presence of colonial structures that force so many of us to live in the afterlife of slavery. And erases the possibility of our humanity from the streets to the archives. In many ways, my book, as well as my intervention today, is born from my own experience as a Black Latina immigrant scholar who lives in translation, in between belonging and unbelonging. And it emerges out of the necessity, I should say my necessity, to hope radically, as Jonathan Lear urges us to do, for another way of being, for a future being free from the afterlife of colonial violence. What I do in the work is propose Black Latinidad as an epistemology, as a way of understanding and producing knowledge from the site of unbelonging, from what Christina Sharp calls the unfinished project of emancipation. That is, I read Black Latinidad not as an embodied identity nor as a social construct, but as a point of entry and as a set of methods that allow us to go beyond concepts of homogeneous racial and citizenship exclusion. It naturalizes the nation as a site of belonging and invites us instead to think and know from a productive detour, both away from and in contradiction to the colonial order that sustains national notions of belonging in the present still. to think through Black Latinidad is thus a project of Black possibility, of Black living, of Black being, for the unfinished implies the ability of an opening, a space for reshifting, that epical shift that Deborah was talking about earlier. That which is not finished is still in the making, and the process invites possibility. Central to translating Blackness is a concern with the colonial structures that link anti-immigrant racism and anti-Blackness in the 21st century, producing globalized categories of human beings that are susceptible, to use Derby Hernandez's terminology, to exclusion, ethnic minorities, immigrants, and racialized non-white subjects. Contradicting the practices that often separate the work of racial justice from the work around immigrant rights, what I'm hoping to do through translating Blackness is to grapple with the multiple ways that people who are deemed to unbelong create collective possibilities of being and belonging through cultural and political acts of alliance building that translate historical experiences of dispossession, such as slavery and segregation, into present-day political contestations of human belonging. Think of Black Lives Matter or No Human Being is Illegal. In 2011, after the state of Georgia banned undocumented students from accessing its top public universities because they, undocumented immigrants, were, and I quote, taking seats away from citizens, I joined a group of activists, including students, professors, and community members, to create an alternative school for the undocumented. We called it Freedom University Georgia. Following in the steps of the Black Freedom Schools that decades before had sustained liberationist educational models in the US South, it opened its doors to 32 students in October 2011. Freedom University became not only a response to the racist legislation that sought to exclude undocumented students from accessing higher education, it also developed into the national model for resistance at a time in which anti-immigrant sentiment was on the rise in the United States and Europe. I learned many lessons as a Freedom University teacher, organizer, and co-creator. I learned to be an effective and engaged scholar. I learned to teach in ways that are transformative, that create community, and that promote social justice. I also learned the very tangible, intrinsic, and often subtle ways in which anti-immigrant racism is entangled with anti-Blackness. How, as Elizabeth Garibay, whose testimony is in front of you right now, explained in her interpolation of Jim Crow, anti-immigrant racism emerges out of the same colonial capitalist structures that engender slavery and that continue to sustain the structures of colonialism, through which I argue Black, brown, and underprivileged racialized immigrant subjects continue to exist in the afterlife of slavery, suspended in a space of unbelonging to the nation and the world. And while these are lessons that can be deduced by reading the archives in what I call elsewhere contradiction against dominant versions of histories and accepted hegemonic truths, it was in organizing in the US South, in listening to young undocumented students like Elizabeth, and through a strong alliance with local Black American communities, that this 21st century anti-immigrant violence manifests to me clearly and tangibly as an iteration of the afterlife of slavery. It happened one afternoon in September 2011 in a trailer park in Athens, Georgia, where most of the residents are undocumented immigrants. A dozen of us were meeting to organize to support undocumented students when Linda Lloyd, a Black American activist and director of the Economic Justice Coalition, walked into the meeting. Linda had grown up at the tail end of Jim Crow, and during the transition years that follow, one of the most economically segregated counties in this country, the Athens-Clarke County, where 90% of the Black Americans live below the poverty line, and while over 70% of the white Americans are wealthy. So she knew a thing or two about living in the afterlife of slavery. Linda walked around, looked at each of us, nodding to each of us, seeing us, before standing in the center of our circle to address the group. And she said, and I'm never going to forget this, she said, "I have been here before, and we cannot. We will not let it happen again." You see, for Linda Lloyd, the passing of the ban against undocumented students in 2011 was clearly another iteration of what she and many other Black Americans from Georgia had experienced under Jim Crow, a border that divided humans into two categories, belonging and unbelonging. Like Linda, national Black American leaders John Lewis and Angela Davis showed their public support to the undocumented Georgia students in the wake of the ban by linking their exclusion to the history of racial segregation in the South, translating their exclusion through Blackness. As Davis put it, and I quote, "The discourse of immigrants draws from and feeds on the racisms of the past." Their collective nod, their recognition of the historical intersections of immigrant and Black struggles for freedom, provided the Georgia undocumented students with a larger, stronger, and tangible political sustenance from which to speak back, as did Elizabeth, to the state and to the nation. The acute awareness that locals like Linda Lloyd brought to the immigrant struggle not only shaped the nature of our organizing, teaching, and solidarity movement, it profoundly defined or redefined how I, as a Black Latina Dominicana and a scholar of Black Latinidad in the United States, conceptualized, defined, understood, and experienced the relationship between Blackness, immigration, and Latinidad as a continuation of colonialism, as entangled experiences of past and present colonial oppression. Christina Sharp argues that the project of emancipation is incomplete, a fact that leads Black people to live in what Celia Harmon calls the aftermath of slavery. But if slavery was the product of colonial capitalism, we must recognize, as did Lloyd, that the same colonial logic that convinced the world that it was somehow acceptable to profit from capturing and enslaving of Africans and indigenous peoples continues to sustain immigrant as a racialized subhuman category of unbelonging, and racialized immigrant subjects as disposable, consumable bodies without histories, aliens to the nation state and at the service of the global capital machinery. Following this logic, I argue that racialized non-white Latinx immigrants like Maria, Giovanna, and Elizabeth, whose testimonies are on the screen, are also living in the aftermath of colonialism. Their everyday lives are shaped by the continual intersections of race and immigration that produce new categories of undesirables to the nation. Sylvia Winter argues that all of our present struggles with respect to race, class, gender, sexual orientation, ethnicity, struggles over the environment, global warming, severe climate change, the sharply unequal distribution of earth resources, are the result of the colonial structures that define people as human or lesser human. That is, through colonial categories of citizenship that are based on race. For Lisa Lowe, one significant effect of the colonial classification of human versus lesser human is the emergence and dominance of an archive that defined the human through approximations to European values, cultures, and race, which lead to the simultaneously differentiating of non-white populations in colonies as less than human. In the present-day United States, these categories of humanity determines who goes to prison, who gets pulled over by the police, who must show identification in public spaces, who can be left out of institutions, archives, sites, who can run, nap, read, or watch birds in peace. If the human, those who belong, is defined by its proximity to Europe, as both Winter and Lowe have argued, then lesser human, racialized, non-white, minoritized, and immigrant subjects who won't belong are presumed to be expendable, durable, and unstable now, as in the 15th and 16th century. Colonial rules drive migration. Coloniality defines human belonging to the nation and to the world. Immigrant, as deployed in the 21st century, is thus a new category of colonial oppression, new in quotation, and such it exists in the afterlife of slavery. My suggestion is that the oppression of Black people and immigrants of color must therefore be confronted together. The narrative of immigration and the category of the immigrant, particularly in the United States, are intrinsically linked to the great story of America, to the idea that we're a nation of immigrants. And for many immigrants of color in the United States, particularly those of Latinx descent, non-citizen discrimination, or the presumption of illegality, and racism intersect, shaping their access to civic mobility from driving to higher education. That certain immigrants are presumed to be illegal also shapes how racialized ethnic minority citizens who share the ethnic or cultural identity of a racialized immigrant group, such as Latinx in the United States, experience everyday life racism and civic exclusion. For Black Latinx, to give you an example, this manifests in the experience of being pulled over by the police for driving while Black, and then facing detention and deportation for being undocumented. The intersections of race and immigration shape the experience of Black Latinx belonging and unbelonging in the afterlife of slavery in the diaspora. Black Latinx living in the global north, particularly in the United States and Europe, carry with them both the past, slavery, and present immigration experiences of unbelonging, often while navigating other forms of internal and transnational colonialities. Their subjecthood and bodies are bordered through palimpsestic colonialisms. Their experiences and histories can in turn help us make sense of how Black and immigrant intersect in the new millennium, producing other forms of colonized oppression. More importantly, Black Latinidad can help us see possibilities for transnational, anti-colonial, anti-racist forms of contestation that go beyond the nation and that challenge hegemonic notions of racial and ethnic identification. The tensions that produce Black Latinidad as a category in translation, in a simultaneous state of belonging and unbelonging, are central to my engagement of the afterlife of slavery. I see Black Latinidad as the theoretical category for understanding the multiple ways through which Black people experience the afterlife of slavery, through the historical and present intersections of race, colonialism, migration, and citizenship that have shaped their experiences of belonging and unbelonging in their everyday life. The translations of Blackness through Latinidad and the multiple colonial entanglements that shaped the conceptualization of a global Latinx collective exemplify how the categories of race and citizen travel across national paradigms through the movement of bodies, words, objects, and social media interactions. In turn, the cultural, linguistic, political, and historical translation shed light on the prevalence of colonialism and coloniality in the contemporary globalized nation state. So the act of translating Blackness through Afro-Latinx being and knowing makes these colonial entanglements visible. And visibility, in turn, places anti-colonial struggles within a recognizable global historical continuum. There are three testimonies that frame my talk today on the screen that I would love for you to read, delineating the geographies, the ASICs, and the vaivenes, the coming and goings, that frame my conceptualization of Black Latinidad as a site for critical engagement of the afterlife of slavery, and as a political articulation of the interactions of race, colonialism, and immigration in the new millennium. the three sides embodied in each of the undocumented women that speak in this chapter: Elizabeth in the United States, Maria in Hispaniola, and Giovanna in Italy, faithfully and symbolically map my conceptual understanding and genealogical framework of Black Latinidad in constant vivén to and through the Atlantic, via the Caribbean, the United States, and Europe, as it intersects immigration with national belonging and unbelonging. More importantly, these testimonies exemplify the continuum of colonialism and the ruptures of colonial oppression as they appear and reappear on newer sites, such as Italy, of racialization and unbelonging for Black Latinx lives. So in closing, what I'm hoping to leave you with is the invitation to work through and show how translating Blackness can make coloniality visible, how we, through it, we can transfer the epistemological, historical, and cultural experiences of the small collective into a recognizable global market marker to gain access and mobility and to produce social change. The translation of Blackness as employed in each of these testimonies not only summons the universal violence associated with Black bodies, the afterlife of slavery, but also it includes the poetics of Blackness that encompasses a series of cultural and linguistic codes that go beyond the local bodily experience of exclusion from the nation and the state to the collective possibility, to the completion of the project of emancipation. To translate Blackness is to contradict the nation, as Elizabeth does in her speech. It is to state that Black humanity is to state Black humanity as a global category that belongs beyond, in spite of, and not depending upon the nation. A person is Black at home and abroad, and Blackness, Black belonging, transcend national identity. So I look forward to discussion. Thank you.